Good afternoon, one and all. We will begin our session exactly at 3 o'clock.
हाँ मैम, हाँ हाँ
गुड आफ्टरनून आंबावडेकर सर. Chetna ma'am, are you there?
Yes ma'am, I'm there.
Yes. We will start exactly at 3. We will wait for 5 minutes. It's 2:55.
Okay, fine. Good afternoon, Ambarikar sir. I think sir is not audible. Good afternoon, Shyam ma'am.
Good afternoon, Chetna. Good afternoon, Kadambari.
Good afternoon, ma'am.
We still have 4 minutes to go.
Yeah.
Please ask everyone to mute their to put off their video.
Yes, ma'am. Dear participants, kindly put off your video, disable your video as well as your audio.
Good afternoon, madam.
Good afternoon, sir.
Yeah.
So you could come.
I just managed. Yeah.
Yes.
Okay, I have just because I'll have to again go to doctor's hospital. I'll be there for 5 minutes. Ambedkar sir will be there.
Yes, sir.
Ha. All the best.
Thank you.
Okay.
We'll start.
No, ma'am. Yes. We will start. It's exact 3.
Okay. Good afternoon, everyone. I welcome all the dignitaries as well as our dear participants for our webinar series on Inquisitive Mind. We have successfully conducted 8 webinars, and today for our 9th webinar, we have none other than our Vidya Prasarak Mandal's Bandodkar College Research Coordinator, Dr. Maitri Shah. But before going into detail about Madam, let me give few instructions to our participants, which I have already mentioned. First, kindly mute your audio as well as your video. Disable your video. It's a request to all the participants. Second, if you have any questions with respect to our session, which you will definitely have by the end, kindly put them or write them down in the chat box. Third, feedback link will be provided immediately by the end of the session. It will be put in the session chat box. So kindly open the link and fill in the feedback form at your earliest. Now, moving back to our session, like I mentioned, our today's presenter is Dr. Maitri Shah. Her persona is like a playful child, always curious, always inquisitive. She's ready to learn, then be it younger ones or be it from the older person or from the senior person. She also inspires us to learn every day, and not only that, she makes it a very fun experience. Thank you, ma'am. But now let us learn more about her work profile. But before that, I would also welcome our principal, sir. Thank you, sir, for joining us for this session. Now, I would request our vice principal, sir, of Degree College, Dr. Amba Vadekar, sir, to kindly introduce our today's presenter.
Hello, Ambavadekar sir.
Ambavadekar sir, unmute.
Sir, just a minute.
In the meantime, if our participants face any technical difficulties, they are requested to rejoin the session using the same invitation link.
Chetna ma'am, Ambavadekar sir has left the meeting. Just a minute. We have to wait for one more minute.
Okay, ma'am.
Hello. Good afternoon, everybody. Hello.
Yes, sir, your audio.
Yeah, yeah, proceed. Ambavadekar, sir, proceed.
I'm sorry, some technical glitches were there. Let me have my privilege to introduce my colleague, and today's resource person for webinar, Dr. Maitri Shah. Is working as an associate professor in our college. Last 34 years, she is qualified with MSc, MPhil, and PhD. And she is recognized as a MSc research guide in botany in year 2004, University of Mumbai. And she is recognized in PhD guide botany again in 2008, University of Mumbai. Her priority research areas are tissue culture, herbal medicine, pharmacognosy, and cancer research. Her research activities as a teacher extends terms for 30 years almost. She has completed 60 research papers, and she has to her credit two minor research projects, and she is successfully guided one PhD student, and one is at present pursuing PhD degree, and she has published two books in her credit. So I'm privileged to introduce my colleague, Dr. Saha Madam, and thank you all of you for listening me patiently, and I wish best luck to all of you, and my best wishes to Saha Madam particularly. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Yes, thank you
for the introduction. Now I request our presenter, Dr. Maitri Shah, So please proceed with the presentation.
Thank you, Chetna. Thank you, Ambavadikar sir. And thank you, Venkat sir. Thank you, Venkat sir, for coming.
Thank you.
You had a very, like you had to run back here. So thanks a lot.
Yeah.
Good afternoon to all participants who are here are either researchers, authors, or students. I know all of us love to read. We also love to write. We write assignments. We write blogs. Writing is our passion. Writing is our hobby. And it spreads happiness all around. It spreads happiness to us and our students. What strings us together is that we are authors, we are researchers, and we shoulder a great responsibility. What responsibility? The responsibility of truth that shines in our work we present to the world as our own. Today's topic that we will discuss is about research misconduct. But before we begin, let us understand that research misconduct goes hand in hand with research integrity. I will flip the coin and talk about research integrity first. Research integrity, is it a habit? Research integrity, is it an attitude? The answer is yes to both. Science Europe. Science Europe has defined research integrity as the performance of research to the highest standard of professionalism and rigor in an ethically robust manner. So what does research integrity establish? Again, according to Science Report, research integrity is vital because it creates trust. Trust is the heart of the research process. Researchers are able to trust each other's work. They must also be trusted by the society because they provide scientific expertise that may impact people's life. Should I say, research integrity is a very good habit. No matter what is the consequences, we should inculcate it, and it should be a part and parcel of our everyday researcher's life. So let me flip the coin again and discuss research misconduct. So where do we begin? Okay, let me start with this example. Yes, these are the names. You're familiar with it. This is the journal and this is the paper. I'll spend a few minutes on this slide. As researchers, we know that in the world of medical journals, The Lancet is one of the well-known journals. It is a prestigious journal which was founded in the year 1823. Within a few years, they will be completing 200 years. The Lancet has an impact factor of 60.392 according to Clarivate Analytics 2020. The Lancet on 22nd May 2020 published a paper titled Hydroxychloroquinine or Chloroquinine with or without macrolide for the treatment of COVID-19, a multinational registry analysis. The authors were Mandeep Mehra, Sapan Desai, Amit Patel et al. The paper claimed in their study this study was based on 98,262 hospitalized patients of COVID-19, which is a huge data. They covered 671 hospitals across six continents. 96,000 patients with COVID were considered for this study, and above 81,000 patients of COVID were in the control group. Around 15,000 patients with COVID were given HCQ, alone or in combination. The authors concluded in this paper that HCQ was not beneficial. In fact, it caused cardiac irregularities, and they linked HCQ with a higher risk death among COVID-19 patients. Please understand the consequences of this. The moment this paper was published in the Lancet, World Health Organization halted all the studies on HCQ. Doctors around the world stopped using HCQ as a treatment. Several concerns were raised when this happened. Approximately 180 researchers and scientists all over the world started asking, questioning this paper. They asked for the raw data. They felt the data which was presented was not the true picture. So one thing led to another. And finally, it was found that the data was furnished by a private company called Sodhi Sphere. One of the authors, Sapan Desai, is the founder of Sodhi Sphere. So what happened was that they had to retract this paper by 3rd June 2020. In their retraction letter to the Lancet, the authors noted that Sodhi Sphere would not transfer the full data set, and as it would violate the client agreement. By 4th June 2020, the news spread, and the publication or the publication of the retraction in Lancet. What was the consequences of that? World Health Organization asked all the concerned person to resume the study on HCQ, and the trial for HCQ again it began world over. So I'm sure you are able to gauge what towards which direction I am pointing. Where are my pointers? Okay, the controversial story of these three Indians does not end here. Mandeep Mehra, Sapan Desai, Amit Patel et al. Has also published another paper, Cardiovascular Disease, Drug Therapy and Mortality in COVID-19, in a very reputed journal, the New England Journal of Medicine, NEJM. NEJM was established in 1811. The journal has completed more than 200 years. It has the highest impact factor of 74.699 according to Clarivate Analytics in 2020. The authors were working in a very large data set. In this paper, the authors concluded that blood pressure medicines heightens susceptibility to COVID-19 infection. They proposed that these medicine may increase the risk of becoming seriously ill with the disease. So on June 4th, 2020, this paper was also retracted. In their retraction letter to NEJM, the authors stated that since the authors were not granted access to the raw data, and the raw data could not be made available to the third party auditors, the article was retracted. So, a sad story, but it is a true story. Do we believe in the saying that the end justifies the mean? If so, then we have taken a path where research ethics are ignored. Research integrity is abused, and this leads to research misconduct. Today, I would like to touch upon three domains of research misconduct: fabrication, falsification, and plagiarism. Let us talk about fabrication. The above two cases were a crisp example of fabrication. These were deliberate attempts to fabricate data. There were evidences like of fabrication, And there is no evidence that this misfortune was unintended or something that happened by mistake. Fabrication is always pre-planned. Data is fabricated and published in a journal. Sapiro in 1992 and Chandler have explained fabrication as outright synthesis of experimental data, reporting experiments that were never conducted. It is called as dry labbing, fudging, or outright manufacture of experimental data. Fabrication is done with the sole intention to deceive. It is highly unethical, where research results are altered, images are tampered, photo manipulation is done, image fraud is attempted, and to produce impressive results. This is a serious misconduct. Fabrication sometimes involves fabricating result, graphs, figures, and another high profile retraction we can see in Nature. A group of researchers based at Harvard Medical School have retracted their paper from a report from a reputed journal, Nature. What did they do? They did figure anomalies. And this is the reason why they had to retract their paper. What happens when you get caught, when your paper is retracted? The consequences are severe. A scientist engaged in fabrication will mean end of his career as researcher. Scientific misconduct can lead to dismissal of the faculty, losing research grant. Researchers are blacklisted. Organizations, universities refuse to hire them. Funding resources refuse to sponsor them. Funding sources refuse to sponsor them. Journals refuse to consider their future articles for publication. A German physicist, Jan Hendrik Schön, was famous for his work on semiconductors. Now, what did he do? He published his work on single molecule semiconductor in prominent journals like Science, Nature. He gained worldwide attention for his findings. The physics community, however, never considers his near perfect results as genuine. Much later, Schön acknowledged that yes, he omitted some data from his findings, and he did this to show more convincing data results. Yes, he did that. So what happened to him? In 2004, that is 204, Jan Hendrik Schön was stripped of his doctorate degree, and most of his paper were retracted from most of the journals. So that is the consequences of fabricating results. Falsification. This is another kind of misconduct. Falsification is manipulating research material, manipulating images, data, equipment, and processes. Falsification includes changing or omitting data results in such a way that the result of the research is not accurately represented. A person may falsify data to so that the end result of the study looks impressive. The next research misconduct is falsification, of course, and falsification involves manipulating, changing, omitting data or result. And a research paper in the journal Science was retracted. The title of the paper was Human SIR T6 Promoted DNA Resection Through CTIP Deacetylation. It appeared in 2010, and this was retracted because there was falsification of data. The same was the case with a paper published in Nature in the year 2013 by falsify. What's the reason people falsify? Science, research, publishing leads to career pressure. This is a career-driven discipline. If a scientist has good reputation, it is easy to get support and it's easy to get funding. What does good reputation mean? Well, a good reputation for a scientist means that he has publication in high-profile journal. He has a high H index. He has a high citation index, and that happens if you have a paper in a reputed journal. Have you heard of the expression publish or perish? Clearly, research integrity takes a toss if we follow this expression, because desperate scientists resort to falsification and fabrication just for this reason. Now, let us talk about plagiarism. Plagiarism in Latin means to kidnap, a very simple term, to kidnap. Plagiarism means kidnap. According to Collins in the English dictionary, plagiarism is a practice of using or copying someone else's idea or work and pretending that you thought of it and you created it. So that is plagiarism. Plagiarism is almost like a copyright infringement. It is unethical. If an author or a musician or any other person for that matter has taken a copyright for his or her work or has applied for trademark logo and you use that material without permission, then what happens? What is it called? It is called as copyright infringement. Is it punishable? Yes. Infringement is punishable by law. And in India, we have a Copyright Act 1957 in place for the same. So what about plagiarism? Plagiarism is academic dishonesty. Plagiarism by itself is not a crime, but it is a serious ethical offense. Stealing information, thought, idea, figures, illustration, etc. is plagiarism. Is it punishable by law? Well, it probably is not punishable by law, but it is unethical in this scientific world. This scientific world is a close-knit family and it does not pardon offenders. It is often seen that plagiarism can lead to copyright issues and copyright infringement is punishable. So plagiarism can be punished by law. If there is a book and you have copied some paragraph in your paper from that book, then it is plagiarism. If there is an article or a book and you have copied the entire thing and put it in your thesis, then that is copyright infringement. So plagiarism can sometimes lead to copyright infringement. So what can you plagiarize? You can plagiarize word, you can plagiarize findings, you can plagiarize computer programs, electronic material, illustrations, lecture, printed material, ideas, graph, graphic representation, information, diagram, writing, or any other original work can be plagiarized. So let me give a gist of the different types of plagiarism. And the first plagiarism which I want to start with is global plagiarism. So what is global plagiarism? Global plagiarism means that you take the entire work of a person and you write it in your own manuscript and pass it off as you pass it off as your own. It is called as literal copying. You reproduce word to word without permission or without acknowledgement. So that is called as global plagiarism. So is global plagiarism an ethical problem? Yes, it is the most severe form of plagiarism. The next one is verbatim or copy and paste plagiarism. I think this is a plagiarism which is very, very common among teachers, students, and anyone related to academics. It is also a direct plagiarism, and it is a serious offense. What happens over here? One, you copy a part of the text from the original document and paste it in your own document or in your own manuscript. Two, you do not attribute to the source. Three, you may delete few words, you may add some of your own words, you may use synonyms, but more or less you copy that part from another manuscript and you do not cite the author or cite the source. Then in that case, it is called as verbatim plagiarism. And this is the copy-paste plagiarism, and it is a very, very serious research misconduct. The question is, I don't want to plagiarize. So how do I quote? If you don't want to plagiarize and you have taken a direct lines from a particular author, what do you do? So if you quote an author, insert quotation marks. The quotation marks are very important. At the end of the quotation mark, use brackets. Inside the brackets, write the author's name, the year, or the page number. Cite the entire source. When you get to the bibliography page, write the full reference. If you do that, in that case, it is not plagiarism. The next type of plagiarism is paraphrasing. According to Merriam-Webster Online Dictionary, paraphrase is a restatement of a text, passage, or work, giving meaning in another form. Paraphrasing by itself is not plagiarism. But then how does it come under plagiarism in research manuscript, or why is it considered as a research misconduct? Because in English we teach paraphrasing, but when it comes to scientific writing, paraphrasing is a research misconduct. You see, one, while paraphrasing, we paraphrase, we reconstruct, we reword, and we rephrase the text in our own word. Second, we add everything to our own manuscript. Three, the third step, we forget sometimes intentionally, sometimes unintentionally, we forget to cite the author. If that is the case, then this kind of paraphrasing is a misconduct, and it comes under paraphrasing plagiarism. And this is one of the severe and very serious plagiarism, which is prevalent in research scientific writing. The next one is very common, especially with teachers and students. It is called as mosaic plagiarism. So what is mosaic plagiarism, especially nowadays? If you search for online resources, we open so many papers. So we have five papers in front of us, and we take, we are writing our own manuscript. So what do? We take one line from one paper, we take the second line from the second paper, we take the third line from the third paper, and that way we take so many papers. We take one line from each and then we put them together. And when we put them together, we reconstruct it and we present it in our manuscript as our own. Now, when we are consolidating this particular paragraph, for which we have taken the input from five different papers, and when we do not cite those sources, what happens? What are we doing? We are plagiarizing. And this kind of plagiarism is called as patchwork plagiarism, or it's also called as mosaic plagiarism. I think this is a very common thing, plagiarism, which most of the teachers and the students, especially the students, do when they are writing notes. Citing incorrectly or incorrect citation. Incorrect citation, as an author, you have every intention to give credit to the author. You have taken lines from various papers, and you have prepared a manuscript, and you have given citation. But the question is, have you given the reference correctly? Have you done it correctly? Have you followed the correct format? It is important that you check whether the format is correct, whether the source you have cited is correct. If it is not done properly, even if you have cited, it becomes incorrect citation, and it is a type of plagiarism. So incorrect citation is also called as accidental plagiarism. What is accidental plagiarism? Accidental plagiarism occurs when a person neglects to cite their source, or misquotes their source, or unintentionally paraphrase the source, and using similar words, group of words, or sentence structure without attribution. Sometimes what happens is that a scientist may be writing down the sentences from various sources, and after that, because they have taken from various sources, they write down the source's name incorrectly. So though they have an intention to write the citation, because of this mistake, they often do accidental plagiarism. And accidental plagiarism is also a misconduct. Usually we feel that whatever is available in online, or whatever we see on the net, is free. Please remember, it is a common mistake. Check the copyright symbol and choose the copyright free images or videos which are available on net. Now, if you see this particular video which is playing, you can see that I have not written the citation. Is it plagiarism? Yes, it is plagiarism, because it clearly tells me that citation is needed. So not only the text, it is the images, it is the videos, whatever you are using has to be cited. It has, if citation is needed, then you have to credit the author. Now, but then there are certain Creative Commons licenses which are available. If you look at this slide, I'd like you to come towards the left-hand side, lower end. Now you can see what is written, attribution free options. So in the attribution free options, if you look at this logo, you can see it is written C, capital C, and it is crossed. So whatever work is present in public domain, and if it has got this symbol, then in that case, you can use the work however you like, without permission or attribution. The copyright of this particular material has expired. So you can use this material without without permission or attribution. Now, if you come to the right side lower end, you can see a second logo where it is there is a cross, a zero sign and a cross, public domain. It is called as Creative Commons Zero. So what about the papers or the photographs which have this symbol? You can use this work however you like, without permission or attribution. The creator has released it to the public. So if this is the case, you can use these two, wherever these two symbols are there, you need not give attribution. Now let us come up. So you can see there are six symbols, and the least restrictive one is towards the left, and the most restrictive one is towards the right. So let us see the symbol. If the Creative Commons license has capital C, and the letter BY, if that letter is there with this logo, it means that you can use the work and do whatever you like as long as you give attribution. So you can do whatever you want, but please do cite this whatever text you or the photograph you have taken. If you come to the next logo, it is again a Creative Commons license, and it is written BY and SA. So you can see the same BY logo and SA logo, which is the opposite of C. So what happens over here? If you add to or change the work, you must share it with the same BY-SA license. Okay, this now is little more restrictive. Now let us go to the third one, BY-ND. You can use the work as long as you don't change it in any way. So there is little more restriction. What is BY-NC? You can use the work and add to it or change it, but you cannot make money from it. So if you are using this and you want to sell the product, no, you cannot do that. If you do that, it is in copyright infringement. Okay, and it is punishable. The next one, BY-NC-SA. If you change the work, you must share it with the same license, and you can't make money from it. Again, you can see this is more restrictive. And finally, the most restrictive one, BY-NC-ND. What does it say? You can use and share the work, but you can't change it or sell it. So you cannot earn money. You cannot use it for any other purpose. You can only share and work with it. So this was the next one. Now, the next one is self-plagiarism. And usually when it comes to self-plagiarism, we say, what plagiarism? It is my own work. I'm authoring a new book, or I'm writing a new paper, research paper. My earlier paper had a good paragraph in the introduction, or maybe in the methodology, or in the conclusion. The language was good. It was nicely expressed. And the words which I had used, the phrases which I had used, was at a higher level. So let me include this in my present paper. And I will add it verbatim, that is word to word. So does anyone has an objection to it? It is my work after all. I have written the manuscript. It is mine. What is the need of attribution? What is the need of citation? Isn't it? This is what we all feel. We take up one of our old paper, we see what we have written, and we try to copy the same thing in our second paper. Yes, you are the author of the first paper. Yes, it is on your name. Yes, you have published it. And that's the catch. You have published it. Once you have published it, it is a part and parcel of the journal. The journal has the copyright for that particular paper. You cannot reproduce that paragraph verbatim. It is called as plagiarism, and it is called as self-plagiarism. Many of us don't realize it, but it is very important that once we publish a paper, we cannot use it unless we cite it. And this has often been seen in cyber plagiarism. It has been seen in digital plagiarism, image plagiarism, and all these things come under self-plagiarism. Finally, why do researchers plagiarize? Is it ignorance? Is it due to lack of writing skill? I think this is a very important point. Writing skills. Why do you need to plagiarize if you are good in writing? But then many of us are lazy. So we like faster result with less effort. And we always believe that where is the chance of getting caught? It's always intentional. But the most dangerous part is we believe in ethics, but we don't practice it. So many of us believe in ethics, but how many of us practice it? So how do we avoid plagiarism? We avoid plagiarism by citing your source. Please do cite the source. Include quotations if it is a direct manuscript which you are copying. Why don't you present your own idea? If you are paraphrasing something, please do cite it. The moment you follow these steps, you can avoid plagiarism. Now, I'd like to talk about some of the things which UGC has presented in front of us. You see, University Grant Commission has a few regulations on research integrity, research and research misconduct in place. The regulation defines that the practice of taking someone else's work or idea and passing them as your own is plagiarism. To curb this, UGC regulation stipulates that higher education must implement technological measures to check plagiarism. They have advised present other person's work as your own is plagiarism. So they have advised that you don't do that. Not using quotation mark is plagiarism. Copying major part of others' work is plagiarism. Wrong citation is plagiarism. So these are the things which UGC has told. According to UGC, how can you avoid plagiarism? Very simple, I have told it before. Use quotes, give citation, mention the source below the images or tables which you have used. In case of paraphrasing, give due credit to the authors. They have some exemptions from plagiarism. According to UGC regulation, laws, standard equation, symbols, quoted work which is either in public domain, some of them are in public domain, references, table of content, bibliography, preface, and acknowledgement, they are exempted from plagiarism. Of course, they are universal. So they cannot come under plagiarism. If you see the bibliography, in bibliography you will get 100% plagiarism because these papers have been repeatedly quoted in different papers. So these are the things. Symbols are universal, so they cannot come under plagiarism. They have been exempted from plagiarism. So UGC has put forward some part of the paper or of the manuscript where there is zero tolerance. And the core area of your manuscript, that is the hypothesis, the recommendations, abstract, summary, conclusion, result, observation. This is the region where plagiarism will not be tolerated. So these are the core areas where there is zero tolerance for plagiarism. Now, UGC regulation states different level of plagiarism. There is a new anti-plagiarism policy which allows 10% content similarity. With similarity above it, students will be asked to withdraw their manuscript. I'm talking about students who are in research. So anything above 10%, they will be asked to withdraw the manuscript. The policy was drafted in 2017, and it was recently approved by HRD Ministry. What they say is that if the similarity is between 10 to 40%, that is level one, then they will be asked to rewrite the manuscript. If it is between 40 to 60%, that is level two, then they will lose one annual increment for similarities. If the plagiarism is level three, that is more than 60%, then the person cannot supervise or cannot act as a guide for masters, for MPhil or for PhD for a period of 3 years. This is the new regulation by UGC under promotion of academic integrity and prevention of plagiarism in Higher Education Institute Regulation 2018. Now these are the regulations which I thought you can go through at a later date, at a later time. But I'm interested in this particular circular, and this circular is on self-plagiarism. It has come on 20th April 2020. What does it say? It talks about self-plagiarism. I have just spoken about self-plagiarism, and this also is about self-plagiarism. They are calling self-plagiarism as text recycling. According to UGC, text recycling or self-plagiarism includes republishing of the same paper already published elsewhere without due citation, or publishing a small paragraph of the same work in a new manuscript, again without citation. Reusing data already used in a published work and then presenting it as a new work without citation is again self-plagiarism. Slicing up work, that is, you have a big work, you make it into small pieces, small, and you present several papers out of it, that is self-plagiarism. Paraphrasing a previous work is again without citation, is again self-plagiarism. Now paraphrasing previous work, now this is quite interesting. What people do is that they take an old paper, they completely paraphrase the entire paper, and the same data with the same paper with new words, they again give it for republishing. And that is called as paraphrasing. And this is also a type of self-plagiarism. And this is also an offense according to UGC. And it comes under publishing misconduct. UGC has clarified that self-citation do not add to individual's citation index or H index in blue. It does not add. So it does not work. So it's better not to go for self-plagiarism. Now, there are many free plagiarism checkers and paid plagiarism checkers available. How do they work? What do they check? They check similarity report. They check improper citation. And they check whatever you have uploaded, whether it is paraphrased. So this is the way in which plagiarism detection tool works. If you see, you will find that there are many free checkers which are available. Dupli checker, paper ratter, plagiarism, Risma, plagtracker, plagium, copy leaks, plagiarism checker, plaque scan, Urkund, Q-Tex. So these are some of the free checkers, but they all offer for a, I will be speaking about it, and then paid checker, Turnitin, Scriber, Authenticate, Grammarly, CopyLeak. You can see CopyLeak is written here as well as here. CopyLeak, UniCheck, PlagScan, EasyBib, WriterCheck, Plagiarism Detector, Plagiarism Hunt. So these are the paid checker. Now, I'd like to talk more about this, DupliCheck. It is free of charge, easy to use, but the fact is that it allows only one search per day for unregistered users. PaperWriter, free of charge, but only 5 pages. And they have a premium version. You have to pay $7, $7.95 per month or $95.40 per year. So they promote themselves as free of charge, but then there are many conditions applied. So you can go through them and you can find that that most of them have got conditions applied, though they may promote themselves as free checkers. These are all paid checkers and they are good ones. And I will not say good ones, they are being used. There are many of the publishers, they go for this and many of them are being used by our researchers also. So here, they are available. So they are available on net and we have written a manuscript and we want to check that whether our manuscript shows any plagiarism or is our manuscript unique. So what should we do? Now, if you see on Google search, you put the keyword free plagiarism checker. You put the keyword free plagiarism checker. You will get several links of different plagiarism checker. My advice to you is don't go by their rating. Check for yourself which is suitable for you. So one, the first thing you do is that you open 5 links. In the first few, you can select whatever you want and you select 5 different links and open them in different tabs. Now copy a portion of the paper and paste that portion, the same portion, in all the 5 tabs and wait and watch. Now, I have already done that and I want to show you. The paper which I have taken is In Vitro Callus Induction from Leaf Explant of Lawsonia Inermis L, used as herbal dye. Now, this is one paper which was published by me and my student in Asian Journal of Experimental Biology in 2010. So I took this paper and what did I do? I took the first, that is the first paragraph I have taken. You can see I have highlighted it. And the same paragraph I posted or I uploaded it in PaperWriter. I uploaded in DupliCheck. And what do I get? When I uploaded in PaperWriter, it told me your paper, your whatever you have written, that is your manuscript, is 100% unique. Please understand this. How can it be 100% unique? It has to be 100% plagiarized because I have taken an online source which has already been published and I have put it over here and I have I want to find out whether it is plagiarized. It should be 100% plagiarized, but it is giving me 100% unique. So I reject this. I reject this because I think this is given me 100% original. Now I go to DupliCheck. What do I see in DupliChecker? I see in DupliChecker it has given me. Okay, it has given me that it is 33% unique. It cannot be, but still it has given me 33% unique, and it has given me 67% is plagiarized. Fine, this is acceptable. So it tells me you have plagiarized 67% and 33% is unique. I don't believe it, but still it gives me a better score. The same part, you can see the paper, and this is the part which I have taken, and I have put it in this checker. It is called as RepoCO, and here it tells me 78% of the paper is plagiarized and 22% is unique. Again, okay, fine, I can accept it. And then there is a small CO tool, and it tells me 67% is plagiarized, and it tells me that 33% is unique. Now this also tells me that fine, some portion is unique. But if we come over here, plagiarism detector. Now you can see what has this given me. It has given me that plagiarism is 100%. Now this is what I was after. So it gives me that plagiarism is 100% and uniqueness is zero, and which is really true, because the entire published portion, I have put it here, and it should show me this result that plagiarism is 100 and uniqueness is zero. So I'm for this particular paper, I'm satisfied with this detector. Now I go to another source, it is called as this source, and here what do I find? I find that plagiarized, now this is a search engine report.net. Now this has shown me that again, it has shown me 100% plagiarized and 0% unique. And not only that, it also shows me from which source I have plagiarized. What are the sources of plagiarism, from where I have plagiarized. So it gives me that, and along with that, if you see in the left hand side corner, you will see they have highlighted the sentences which I have plagiarized. So the entire paragraph is shown as plagiarized. So you get this report which tells you plagiarism is 100%. So the reason for disparity is that these tools compare your text against the documents and files stored in their database, and they check for overlaps. Only a handful of tools check the documents against scientific database. So it depends entirely on you, that what have you written and what kind of manuscript you have in front of you, and what you want to see or check whether it is plagiarized. Never go for any one plagiarism detection tool. Always try it out, and then based on the result which you get, select the plagiarism tool with which you are satisfied. Here I'd like to tell you that the slides for UGC was contributed by Kadambari madam, who is from the Department of Library, and this check was done, I have presented last three slides, this particular check was done by my student Dr. Snehal Bangale. So we did it together, so I give credit for the last 6-7 slides to both of them. Thank you to both of them. And these are the references, and I have taken the entire portion from these. And I'd like to thank the research committee. I'd like to thank the Department of Library. I'd like to thank Kadambari madam, who has helped me throughout. I'd like to thank Snehal madam, who has helped me throughout. I'd like to thank Vidya Prasarak Mandal, and I'd like to thank our Venkatraman sir, our principal. I'd like to thank all the participants, and I'd like to thank our vice principal, sir, and all my audience, all the participants who have come not only for my seminar, this ninth seminar, but all the 8 seminar before. Thank you, and thanks a lot. And I'd like to say this, always have an inquisitive mind, good wishes to all researchers here, and a very big thank you.
Thank you, madam. Thank you for wonderful presentation. It is very informative. Okay, but we have few questions. Not I can say a few, but there are many questions. They would like to have the answers. The first question is, are free online plagiarism authentic? Whether the free online plagiarism software are authentic?
Whether they are authentic? Yeah. See, the last test which I showed you, what is the type of manuscript you are using? What have you written? Please check on them. Or otherwise, you go for the licensed version. Go for the one which are paid one. Most of the publishers, they are using the paid checkers.
Then next question is how to write literature survey by avoiding plagiarism?
By giving proper citation. So literature survey is very important. The first part of any PhD is literature survey. My students, I always tell them ki, the first thing you do is literature survey. And when they start with literature survey, they have to write down the source. And if they cite, there is no problem.
And even for methodology also, the next yes. question is on methodology and literature review. It is the same. Okay. Ma'am, there is one question. Self-citation is discouraged. Reasons for it?
UGC has given a list of it. UGC has given a list for it. And you have to go according to that. What is the question? I couldn't get it.
Actually, self-citation is discouraged. Reasons for it?
Self-citation, I think it is not self-citation. It is self-plagiarism is discouraged.
Yeah.
So I think you have got it wrong. Self-plagiarism, according to UGC, is discouraged. And self-citation is not going to increase the index, H index.
Okay, there is the next question. If we take some statements from our own previous paper to ready out next paperwork, so do we take the permission from the journal in which previous paper was published, or just to acknowledge?
You have to cite it. Everywhere the same thing is being told, that if you are using verbatim, if you are using verbatim, that is word to word, please put it under quotations, and then you put, that is citing, you have to put the brackets, name, and then according to the type of journal you are using, it can be APA, it can be MLA, or it can be Vancouver. So whichever type of format is there, you please follow that format, and it will not come under plagiarism. Please remember this. It is always better that you write Saha 2018, and then you paraphrase it, and then write in bracket whatever citation is given. If you do that, then in that case, it is not taken as plagiarism. So if you do that, I just gave an example, you can always do it with other authors also. So paraphrasing it properly and giving it a citation, that is the correct method of writing a paper.
Next question is, ma'am, if a conference was attended by one of the author of a paper to present it, and rest authors didn't attend the same, then do organizers of conference have any right to remove the names of research rest of the authors at the time of publications?
Now, this is a question which has to go to the organizers. So I think it's a thing which has to go to the organizer, this kind of questions.
Okay.
It is the right of the organizer to decide what they want.
Madam, there is a next question. How to cite government data?
how to
cite government data.
Yes, you can always, if you see the government data, there is always they cite as. So WHO has got, I think, if you see if you see in the references, you will find that there is a very easy the method of citing the government government data. Even in open sources, you'll find they give it how to cite it. WHO and then the type of the meeting, and then you will get the link, and then many a times you get the DOI also.
Yes, madam. The next question, madam, kindly throw the light on use of scientific diagrams or contents that we use in presentations or in developing e-content for our students, and that goes on college website. It's like a, being a teacher, we are doing.
Now e-content has become very important, and many a times copyright issue will come up. So, because to tell you the truth, when you are developing e-content and you're using images, you have to be very careful that you use free copyright images. When you, in fact, this is a very different issue from scientific writing. But I'd like to tell you that that's why I put that symbol slide, I have put it, because that tells you which are the diagrams, which are the images that you can use. So whenever you are putting the keywords, put the keyword free copyright images, and only then afterwards you can use those images. Now, because we are going for online presentation, usually what happens is, I'll tell you, right from our childhood, we are taught that this is the definition. You have to reproduce it word to word. So it is in our mindset that we, whatever the teacher tells us, word to word, we have to reproduce. Now, as we come to scientific writing, we are told you are not supposed to write word to word, create your own. So it is not there in our system to paraphrase something and write it. And from our childhood, we know that teacher has taught us and we write the same answer. We never learn how to cite the answer. Okay, who has taught us? My teacher has taken it from which source? Has my teacher acknowledged that source? Do we know which is the source? And when we are writing the answers, are we writing the, are we acknowledging the source? Now, we do not do that because we are not taught that. We don't know that. So in scientific writing, many a times we make this mistake. So if it is ingrained in you that you have taken it from somewhere, so please cite the source. It can be anything. It can be a data. It can be a image. It can be anything, anything. If it is not yours, then you have taken it from some place, then in that case you have to give reference, you have to give acknowledgement to the source. So this is something which is very important. It should be inculcated. It is a very good habit and it leads to research integrity.
Okay, ma'am, there is one, this is the last question. How important is in body citation?
In body citation. Yeah. So I don't have much knowledge about it. In body, biological, or is it material science? Is the question for material science or biological? Because I'll tell you, from biological science, there is one copyright thing which I know is the voice of Amitabh Bachchan that is being copyrighted. So that is one thing which I know. And as far as material science is concerned, again, copyright, it comes under, if you copy it, it comes under copyright infringement. So it has to be, acknowledgement has to be done.
Okay, ma'am.
Thank you.
Thank you. Yes, yes. Thank you, ma'am. Thank you for clarifying all the doubts. Thank you so much.
Ma'am, there is one question in YouTube. Can I ask?
Rohini, can you please ask those questions? I'm not able to access the YouTube due to some technical settings.
Okay. Good afternoon, all. Ma'am, there is one question. What can be done if by mistake same paper is sent for publication and get published in both journals? This is question from Meenakshi Gurav.
Yes. Meenakshi, I know her very well. Meenakshi, the thing is, ethics tell us that once you have sent one paper to one journal, because ethics tells us that you should not send the same paper to another journal. If you do that, then in that case you have violated ethics. So that is the first thing, please keep it in mind. Now what happens is that many a times when you send a paper to one journal, and once upon a time it used to take years for you to get a yes or a no from that particular journal, and then people used to then send it to another journal. Please, this comes under ethical, it becomes an ethical concern, and please do not do that. It's not a good practice. If you have done it, then it is a mistake. If it is done by mistake, then it is of course an accident.
Okay. Thank you, madam. Rohini, madam, is there any more question?
No, ma'am.
Okay. Thank you. So now we are at the end of this session. So on behalf of Research Committee and Department of Library of BN Mangalore College of Science, I take this opportunity to propose a formal vote of thanks. I'm thankful to our today's speaker, Dr. Moitri Shah ma'am, who have delivered an informative and an eye-opening lecture to all of us. Madam, thank you so much for the knowledge, the experience, the examples which you shared with all of us. Thank you so much. I'm thankful to our in-charge principal, sir, Professor Venkatraman, and our vice principal, sir, Dr. Ambavadekar, for their constant support. I take this opportunity to thank our formal principal, Dr. Madhuri Pejawar, madam, for her best wishes. Of course, I thank all the participants who have attended this webinar and made it more interactive. Thank you all of you for your presence. As the title of the webinar is Inquisitive Mind, and this is title is given by Dr. Moitri Shah only, so always to find something new, something innovative. So right from the first webinar, we tried some different platforms. But now after having so many webinars, we could find one good platform where we can gather together for longer time and large number of participants. So thanks to Google Meet for for providing this opportunity for the researcher learners like us. Last but not least, I thank two of my colleagues who have supported me for organizing this webinar. I thank Chetna madam and Rohini madam for making all the technical arrangement. Thank you all of you. One announcement, that we have posted the feedback link in the chat box. I will paste it again. Please submit your feedback. And as usual, as a Saturday series, we will have our next lecture on next Saturday at 3 p.m.
You can say the name.
Yeah.
You tell the speaker next Saturday.
I just request Shah ma'am, can you announce the name of the next speaker?
Yes, the next webinar will be the last webinar of the series, and we have called Reddy Madam as the speaker, and she will be speaking on funding, that is research funding, which are available to us. And she is from Star, and she is a very, what do you say, eminent resource person, which will be coming, who will be joining us next Saturday, same time. And that will be the last in our webinar series. Thank you.
Thank you, madam.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you, sir. Now the session is over. Thank you, all of you. Stay home, stay safe. Bye.